Sorry, brother Majid, everyone, brother Ahmed, Kabayab, mashallah, and Razan, Abdul Hamid, Firuz, all of you, Shamshur, mashallah, Samihuddin, all of you, how are you doing? Kul aamantum bakhair, Eid Mubarak, inshallah, even it's a little bit late. Okay, my dear brothers. Okay, my dear brothers, you know, I thought maybe it will be better for this first class after Ramadan to talk a little bit about what after Ramadan. I thought, because inshallah next week we'll start with the second volume. With the explanation of Bulugh al-Maram, because I found that the khushu', it will be the start of the second volume. So inshallah we'll start it next week. But today, let's just give some few points about Ramadan, especially in the situation that we are, you know, with this corona pandemic. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for everyone. I'm really very happy to meet with you all today after this long time, which is about more than 3 weeks now. So the question always people ask when Ramadan is over and the Eid come, they ask common question: how can I know if Allah accepted my fasting and my prayer? This is one question which is common. Always, you know, people ask this question. The other question is, what after Ramadan? I mean, what's the effect, what's the fruit that we get after Ramadan from fasting, the great month of Ramadan? So let's start from the beginning with the purpose. What is the objective or the main objective or the purpose of fasting? All you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the ayah, which is about prescription of prescribing Ramadan or fasting. قال عز وجل يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. لعلكم, that you may gain taqwa, or attain taqwa. And taqwa, this one word, but it has deep meaning. In fact, it includes all the meaning of adhering to the Islamic teaching. So the one who have taqwa is the one who apply the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in his life. In every matter, no matter if it is worldly matter or something which is related to the hereafter. Therefore, at-taqwa, this is, in fact, the golden gain for fasting and also doing good deeds. So, there are many fruits for being muttaqeen, or one of the muttaqeen, the pious. قال, and you are studying with the Shaykh Fawaz, mashallah, in Surah At-Talaq, the tafsir of Surah At-Talaq, and I'm sure that you went through the explanation of these verses. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِ يُسْرًا. Look at the fruits of taqwa. Allah make way for you from all hardship or difficulties or troubles, that you are safe always. Whenever there are problem or troubles, you know, that Allah Azza wa Jalla will make way up for it. People are very, you know, concerned about their rizq. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ, and give him provision from sources that he never imagined. Allah Azza wa Jalla will send this provision, this risk to you, just being a muttaqi, one of those pious. So, fasting, in fact, Ramadan in the during the daytime, and praying the Taraweeh at night. This, in fact, it's like a training program, very useful to gain sabr, because Ramadan is shahr al-sabr, and fasting, in fact, as the ulama, when explaining the word, the ayah, wasta'inu bis-sabr wa-s-sala, as mentioned, wasta'inu bis-sabr wa-s-sala, and get help with sabr, patience, and salah, and prayer. Some ulama, they explain the word sabr here by fasting. So they say fasting is sabr. So to gain taqwa, you need to have sabr, and you need to train to fast, so you can get sabr and patience, and also to do salah. All this are happened in Ramadan. So alhamdulillah. So Ramadan is over now, and the question, did we get or benefit from this Ramadan? This depends on what you achieved during this great month. Because you see, my dear brothers, many people are fasting. People are fasting, you know, because of different motivation. Motivation, you know. Some people, they fast because of fearing Allah Azza wa Jal and doing their duties. So their intention to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to do the ibadah. And that's the right one. Some people, they said, well, this is a good chance, you know, to lose weight. So they fast for the purpose of caring about their body or health. That's good. But it's not the main purpose of fasting. So what they get, they may lose weight, but they may not, you know, get the reward for fasting. Some others, they fast because everyone fasting. They are in a Muslim community. People around them fasting. So he is fast. And some people, some of these people, as you notice, subhanAllah, so they just flip-flap the timing. They change the time. So the day turn it to night, and the night turn it to day. Which means, instead of having lunch, breakfast, dinner, during the daytime, they switch it to nighttime. So what they do during the daytime, when they are really fasting, they don't eat, what they do? All what they do is sleeping. So they, after they take sahur, they eat, they pray fajr maybe, and that's great that one can pray fajr on time. But then what after? They will sleep, and some of them even they sleep just before Maghrib time, which means they waste Duhur and Asr and other salawat. So people, any ibadah that we do, my brothers, any ibadah, if we want to know the fruits of this ibadah, then the first thing that we need to check is our intention. Our intention. Why? Because as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ, which means that intention is the cornerstone of accepting any good deeds, and also it is, I mean, intention is the one who gets you the real fruit of what you are doing. So, if the person fasts the whole Ramadan, and as he's curious, he say, well, did Allah accept my fasting or not? And it is really a matter for the Muslim to think about this and to ask this himself this question. And he should be, you know, busy by this matter, thinking that did Allah accept from him or he didn't accept his act of ibadah. This matter, you know, something that should think about it all the time. But what do we mean by think about it? That mean will give you motivation to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praying to him, asking him that he may accept what you did. This is why it was mentioned that, you know, in the books of religious studies, they said, when they talk about the Sahaba, and the Salaf al-Saleh, they said they spend 6 months after Ramadan just asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from them Ramadan. Asking Allah azza wa jal that he may accept from them Ramadan. They fast, yes, but then we turn to Allah, oh Allah, accept our fasting. My dear brothers, this is in fact, the Muslim always, whenever he do anything good or any act of ibadah, he doesn't, you know, feel that, well, I did my turn and now it's, you know, for Allah to accept or not. No. Brother Abdul Majid. Brother Abdul Majid, please put Rizmi, brother Rizmi, yeah, okay. Because the voice, the mic was open and there's some noise. So, طيب جزاكم الله خير. So, what we mean here, that the Muslim should turn to Allah whenever he do any good deeds, asking him to accept from him. Look at Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salam. They build the Kaaba, and this mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah. They are building the Kaaba with the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then what they say? Rabbana taqabbal minna. Subhanallah. They ask Allah as well to accept from them. So the Muslim, whenever he pray, he ask Allah that he may accept his prayer. After he finish his dua, he ask Allah to accept his dua. If he did fasting, he ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept his fasting. Now Ramadan is over. We should not forget about Ramadan. We should be concerned, did Allah accept Ramadan from us or not? Now, if the person really concerned and he feel or fear that his fasting was not accepted or he's not sure, then the right thing is to do what? Is to turn to Allah. Oh Allah, my Lord, I ask you, I beg you, please accept my fasting. Accept my fasting. Accept my prayers. So this is very important to make dua after doing any good deeds or any ibadah. Whatever ibadah that you do, you turn to Allah to accept it from you. As I said, because from the beginning when you started this ibadah, you started the intention that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from you. Now, is there any indication or any signs or any traces that tell you that your ibadah is almost accepted? The ulama said, look at your situation after the ibadah, after fasting. Like for example, Ramadan. We fast Ramadan, alhamdulillah. May Allah accept from all of us and all Muslims, inshallah. طيب. And everybody should check himself. Compare his life before Ramadan and after Ramadan. After Ramadan is over now, look at his prayer. I'm looking at my prayer. Do I care more about my prayer? Am I highly motivated to do the salah on time, to do more of the nawafil, to spend more of the time in dhikr after salah, enjoying, you know, and feel very happy. And whenever I sit or stand in front of Allah and do my prayer, do I now, my prayer is more done on the right time than before? So if the person see a sign that his situation or his prayer, either by timing or the way that he do it, perfect. After Ramadan, that's mean, alhamdulillah, is good sign that my prayer in Ramadan, my taraweeh, inshallah, by the way of Allah, it will be accepted. The same thing also for fasting. Now after fast, I fast the 30 days of Ramadan, alhamdulillah, that's great. But is fasting only limited to Ramadan? Or there are many optional fasting? In fact, the Muslim, whenever he finds a chance, he should fast. Because fasting only one day, it has great reward. The Prophet ﷺ said, the one who fasts one day, only one day, any day, not this fixed day which is mentioned like Ashura or Arafah, any day that you fast, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will distance his face away from the hell for the distance of 70 years. 70 kharifa, 70 years, the distance of walking or traveling or flying bird, as some ulama they have different explanation for the expression of timing when it's mentioned about the distance here, when it's referred to years. So it's really great reward. And the Prophet ﷺ advised us that after fasting Ramadan, it is recommended to fast 6 days from the month of Shawwal, which is this month. Now today is the 15th. Still, people who fasted the 6 days, alhamdulillah, those who didn't fast, still they have a chance till the end of the month. They have 2 weeks to fast. So fasting 6 days, mentioned in the hadith, the one who fasts Ramadan, the whole Ramadan, and followed by fasting 6 days of Shawwal, it is like, the one who is fasting the whole year, Siyam al-Dahr, the whole year, the whole time. That means all his life is fasting. Because as you know, by the grace of Allah Azza wa Jal, Al-Hasanatu bi'ashri amthaliha. When you do one good deed, Allah reward you 10 times. So fasting Ramadan, if you get that, you get the reward of fasting 10 months. And fasting 6 days, that means the reward of 60 days, which is mean 2 months. And the year is only 12 months. So in this way that, alhamdulillah, you almost fast the whole year. Look at this great reward. Also, fasting 3 days every month. It is recommended to fast Al-Ayyam al-Bidh, which is like this month. It was Friday, Saturday, and today is Sunday. So it was 13, 14, and 15. It's highly recommended to... But if a person, for example, he doesn't want to fast the Friday, like this time, the 13th was on Friday. He said, Friday is my family day. Is it okay for him to fast Saturday and Sunday? I mean the 2 days left, 14 and 15. Yes, it is. Don't listen to the whisper of the shaitan who will tell you, since you didn't fast the 13th, then it's not, right to fast the 14th or the 15th. No. Fast whatever you can, even it is one day, but at least continue fasting. For sure it is better to fast the 3 days, but it is better also to fast one day than fast nothing, or that the person doesn't fast any day. So this is very, very important. So the Muslim or the fasting is not limited to Ramadan only, but we still have other days, Thursday and Monday, Siyam Ashura, the day of Arafah. There are many good days to fast. But my dear brothers, now after Ramadan, we are after Ramadan, and alhamdulillah, we were trained to fast. Therefore, it is good for the Muslim to start a new system in his life, to make fasting as part of his task or as part of his life plan, that he fasts at least, one day in the month. It is better to list, you know, fast 3 days. This is a sunnah. But at least fast. So if the person, he found himself that, you know, mashallah, alhamdulillah, after Ramadan, I am fasting more days than before Ramadan. Before, I don't care about fasting. Now I love to fast. That means, inshallah, this is a good sign that your fast in Ramadan was accepted. Subhanallah. So because the ulama said, Al-hasanatu taqulu ukhti ukhti. The good deeds say and calling my sister. That means, you see, another hasana. Because good deeds leads to good deeds or more good deeds. Same as bad deeds, it will lead to more bad deeds. This is why the Muslim, whenever, you know, as we, you know, as you know, we are as a human being, we are weak, and sometimes in certain time, out of our weakness, we may commit a sin. What should we do? If the person didn't repent from that sin right away, this sin may lead to another sin. With another sin, and then accumulated many sins till it's covered the heart. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Mutaffifin, what Allah Azza wa Jal said, كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. What was covering their heart, so they don't see the truth, they don't see the guidance, is what? مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. الران. This many sins that they commit, you know, till it's covered the heart. So he doesn't know the truth, he doesn't see the guidance, always he's following his own desire. So the Muslim should be afraid, you know, whenever he commit even a tiny sin. This is what they call it, ulama, shu'm al-ma'asiyah. Subhanallah. Shu'm al-ma'asiyah. Disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it caused a lot of trouble for the person. Maybe in his religion, or maybe in his worldly life. This is why the Muslim always alert. Whenever he commit any sin, he should run away. I mean, run back to Allah Azza wa Jal. Return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking him to forgive him, to clear this sin, work hard for the cure of the effect of this sin by doing more good deeds to cover it up. So, bad deeds will lead to bad deeds. The same thing as good deeds will lead you and guide you to more good deeds. So after Ramadan, look at your situation. I look at myself. How is my life before Ramadan and after Ramadan? If it is the same, nothing changed. Not more interest for more prayer or more fasting or more ibadat or more recitation of the Quran, that's mean nothing changed in your life. If it was worse, this is really dangerous. That's mean instead of getting benefit from Ramadan, that's mean I wasted my chance to get closer to Allah Azza wa Jal in Ramadan. But if it is, alhamdulillah, the person, he found himself after Ramadan getting more, you know, in good deeds and more, you know, close to the Quran, reciting more of the Quran, fasting more days, doing more prayers. So that's mean great. Like some people, you know, about Taraweeh or Salatul Layl, Qiyamul Layl, this is another issue. Qiyamul Layl, is it limited to Ramadan? Many people, all what they know, you know, they the prayer of the night, they know it only in Ramadan. And after Ramadan, it's good to, if they did their witr. They pray Isha, and then they do the witr the whole year. In Ramadan, he may pray some rak'at. But is Salatul Layl limited to the Quran? Limited to Ramadan? It's not. Because, my dear brothers, as it's mentioned, they said, Salatul Layl shi'aru salihin. Salatul Layl, that's mean praying at night. This is the sign or the character of the righteousness. So the Muslim should also give some time at night to pray even two rak'ah. Make it in your schedule to pray at night and keep to do it every night, even if you do two rak'ah. But the important thing is to keep doing this. Some people, they are after Ramadan maybe highly motivated. He pray maybe 10 or 20. He want to continue the Taraweeh, but after a few days, then he will get lazy. He feel it is very, you know, get tired or feel it is too much. And little by little till he forget the and never pray any rak'ah. No. Look at yourself. Make for yourself a plan to do two rak'ah or four rak'ah that I commit to do it every night. And B, this is one in my schedule. I do it at night. And the more you do that of the salah, the more you're close. Salatul Layl, my dear brothers, you don't know how much it has effect on the believer. Salatul Layl, as we mentioned, Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Subhanallah, get help, seeking help through what? Sabr and salah. And Salatul Layl is very important. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said what? خَيْرُ أَعْمَالُكُمُ الصَّلَاةِ. In general, خَيْرُ أَعْمَالُكُمُ الصَّلَاةِ. The best of all your good deeds is salah, prayer. Why? Because you are, when you are praying, you disconnect your relation, your sight, your hearing, even your movement, and even looking around or left or right or up or anywhere, and you concentrate in your salah, standing in front of whom? Of the one who created you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Front of Allah Azza wa Jal. You left everything behind, and you care that I am in front of Allah. This is why some scholar, they said, when the Musalli said, Allahu Akbar, look at this movement. When he said, Allahu Akbar, that means he's throwing everything behind and say, Allahu Akbar, I am with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And pray. So, and when you know Allah and you be with Allah, then Allah will be with you all the time with His help. So, khayru أعمالكم الصلاة. It has, why? It has recitation of the Quran. Prostration, bowing, showing humble, submissions, putting this head and this mind and this face down the ground for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You feel that when you put in that position, you feel that you have no power, but you depend on Allah in everything. And when you are with Allah, Allah will be with you. This is why the Prophet said, خَيْرُ عَمَالُكُمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Because it is communication. You are communicating with the one who created you, with Allah Azza wa Jal. Subhanallah. طيب. And what is the best of all salah? We know that there's a sunan al-rawatib, and we do more prayers. First of all, the best of all prayer, for sure, is the obligatory prayer. But we are not talking about obligatory prayers. We are talking about optional prayer. What is the best of all prayer? What is it? Salatul Layl. Salatul Layl. This mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, خَيْرُ الصِّيَامِ خَيْرُ الصِّيَامِ صيامه شهر الله المحرم. The best of all fasting is fasting during the month of Muharram. وخير الصلاة صلاة الليل. And the best of all prayers is the prayers at night. Night prayers. Why it is, you know, very honored and highly rewarded? My dear brothers, because when you pray at night in the darkness, this is in fact, there is strong evidence of what? Of sincerity. Why? Because here you are at your room It is dark. Everybody is sleeping. You are alone. There is no way the shaitan will come and tell you and whisper to you that you are showing off or you want to please other people. There's no way for him to say this. You know that you are alone and that the only one who is seeing you and will reward you is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why there's nothing to distract your attention, your heart, with your mind, with your sight, with your movement, your body. You are facing your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala and concentrating in communicating with Allah Azza wa Jal by praising Him, by reciting His word, by invoking Him and supplicating, asking Him in whatever matter that you want from this life or the hereafter. So this is why the Muslim should not just after Ramadan he forget about fasting and forget about Salah, because this is the source for your success and this is the source of your strength in this life and also that will lead you to the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal and to the success of the hereafter. Remember this ayah, repeat it and try to apply it in your life and you will see how much or what's the fruit of this. وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَةِ. Subhanallah. استعينوا, get help, support, by what? By doing prayer and be patient. And we mention patient, one of the main meaning of patient is fasting. And also, fasting, the purpose of fasting is to teach you to be patient. And subhanAllah, there is similarity even in the reward. Even in the reward. And this mentioned in the Quran. And in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talk about those who have patience, what he said? قال عز وجل, إنما يوفى الصابرون أجرهم بغير حساب. Verily, those who are patient, they will get their reward countless. You can't count it. Nobody know what is this reward. Beyond our imagination, even we cannot count it. Countless. Subhanallah. And when you look at the fasting, when look at the fasting on the other side, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reported the hadith Qudsi when he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the Prophet sallam is reporting about his Lord, about Allah azza wa jal. The Prophet said that Allah azza wa jal said, kullu amal ibn adam lah. Whatever deeds or good deeds that son of Adam do is for him. It's for him. That means there is fixed reward for it already. العش الحسنة بعشرة أمثاله. If he good one, if he did one good deed, he will be rewarded 10 times. And then what? إلا الصوم, except fasting. فإنه لي. Fasting is for me. وأنا أجزي به. Fasting is for me, and I am the one who will give the reward. Now, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling you, He didn't, He said, whatever you do, you will get 10 times. But for fasting, I will decide, I will give it. What do you expect from the generous one, subhanahu wa ta'ala? What do you expect? What do you expect from the merciful? The one who everything is in his hand, Azza wa Jal. When he said, I will reward you, I will give you the reward. That means you cannot count what's the reward that Allah Azza wa Jal will give you. So look, you know the similarity between fasting and sabr. The reward for fasting and sabr is countless, which means that fasting is one of the aspect of patience and also one of the way to train you and lead you to patient, to be patient. So alhamdulillah, after Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us a chance to train ourselves for patience through fasting and also by getting near to Him by what? By praying at night. Because when you are praying, you are near to Allah. And when you put your face on the ground, humble to Allah Azza wa Jal, you are very near. And this mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِ فِي السُّجُودِ. The nearest time or position that you are to Allah Azza wa Jal when you are at the prostration position, at sujood. This is why it is recommended to make a lot of dua in sujood. And this supported by the ayah when Allah Azza wa Jalla said, "Kalla la tuti'hu wasjud waqtarib." Wasjud, prostrate, waqtarib, and come near. So when you prostrate, you are in the nearest point of your life to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you take this chance when you are prostrate, subhanallah, at sujood, especially at night. Night prayer, nobody there, only Allah Azza wa Jal looking at you and hearing you. And then you get whatever in your chest. Complain to Him, asking Him to get you out, you know, of all the troubles that you face in this world. Asking Him to give you support to be a righteous person, to be a good mu'min, good believer, to strengthen your faith, to give you the best of this world and in the hereafter. All when you are prostrating at night. So my dear brothers, it's very important for the Muslim to keep what he learned in Ramadan. The third point is, which is the last and I'll conclude with, so I leave some time for your question, is what we used to do in Ramadan, you know, plus fasting and praying. Recitation of the Quran. Some people, they know the Quran only in Ramadan. And some even they don't finish the whole Quran in Ramadan. Subhanallah. Al-Quran, the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Reciting the Quran, that means you are listening. Allah Azza wa Jal is talking to you, speaking to you. This is the word of Allah Azza wa Jal. And subhanallah, the Quran, whatever, whenever you read the Quran, you'll never get bored. And this is one of the miracles of the Quran. Look and try and ask anybody. When you read one book that was made or written by people, you will read it one time. You like it. You may read it another time. Let's say read it 3, 4 times. But then you get bored. You know what is there. And it is just repetition. But the Quran, even Surah Al-Fatiha, subhanallah, every time we recite it, you feel that it's still you enjoying the recitation of the Surah. So the same thing for the Quran. In the Quran, you find stories. You find, Allah Azza wa Jal give you many examples about, He give you glad tiding. What will you expect if you are righteous? Talking about Jannah, talking about the hereafter, talking about rivers and gardens and pleasure, which is waiting for you if you are righteous. Give you motivation. At the same time, give you warning, especially for those disbelievers or those disobedience, those who disobey Allah Azza wa Jal, by reminding you that after this life, everybody will be accountable for every sin or every act he do. So this will keep you away from this way. Warning, one side, glad tiding, on the other side, always is a Quran reminder. This is why, my dear brothers, some people, they explain it, you know, the meaning of ayat, when Allah Azza wa Jalla said, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Now they said, what does it mean? إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Salah is keeping away or prevent you from doing shameful act or anything which is bad. It's not just by praying only. Because there are some people who are praying, at the same time they are committing many sin, even major sin. So what's the meaning of this verse? Some ulama, they said, this is the salah tanha wa la tamna. Now what's the difference between tanha wa tamna? Tanha, to stop. Okay? Tanha, to tell you don't do it. تمنع, prevent. In fact, الصلاة تنهى. That's me. Why? So the ulama said, because when the Muslim, he's in prayer, he's standing behind the imam, or he's reciting from his memory, or from the mushaf, reciting the word of Allah. So during this salah, he's reading the word of Allah, who commanding him to do certain thing which is good, or commanding not to do prohibited things. So in this way, the salah, in fact, guide you so you will avoid disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just to wrap up this words, I say, after Ramadan, we should continue what we learn in Ramadan. More fasting, more salah, especially at night. Okay, keeping always connected with the Quran. The Quran. And my dear brothers, we should put for ourselves plan and stick to this plan. No matter what happened, stick. And do a plan that you can do. Don't, you know, do something which is very hard to do for you to do, to make it very, for said, for example, okay, every night I will pray 20 rak'ah, and then you get bored and get tired. No. Put for yourself plan to pray even 4 rak'ah, but keep it. Put for yourself a plan to read in the Quran at least one hizb, that's mean half of the juzu. But keep it. Even if you miss it one day, make it up the following day to continue. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, أحب الأعمال إلى الله أحب أدومه وإن قل أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. The most beloved act of good deeds, beloved to Allah عز وجل, the continuous one, even it is a little. Even it is a little, but it's always continuous. So جزاكم الله خير. Alhamdulillah that I meet with you again after Ramadan. We ask Allah عز وجل and pray to him that he may accept our fasting of Ramadan and our prayers in Ramadan, and keep us always, you know, in this straight path, doing more of fasting, more of prayer, more of recitation of the Quran, more of the good deeds, getting near to him by taqwa, increase our iman, increase our taqwa, and save us and our family, our children, our parents, and all Muslims from this pandemic which covered the whole world. And may Allah save the whole humanity of this corona pandemic, and take it away from the globe, from the world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us all in doing more good deeds, and accept whatever he help us to do, and keep us on the straight path. Jazakum Allah khair. And now you have a time, brothers, to ask if you want to have any question related to this subject or anything which is in your mind. Jazakum Allah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay, brother. Any question, yeah, Sheikh?
The Sultan, please speak your question.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Just wanted to ask you, Sheikh, regarding making sajda. You said that it's the way we come closer to Allah. So can we just make sajda anytime we like and make dua, and, or it has to be through a specific way?
Well, you see, there's different types of sujood, my dear brothers. Okay? There is sajda, which is done when you are, the regular one, what is in the salah. Okay? This is the sujood of the salah. There is sujood called sujood tilawa. This is when a person is reciting the Quran, and then you come across sajda. This is called sujood tilawa, sajda of recitation. So you make sujood, and in that sujood you make dua, no problem. Okay. There is sujood which is called sujood al-shukr. Sujood al-shukr. That means you are making sujood after Allah Azza wa Jal grant you some ni'mah, some grace. Let's say, for example, you were sitting and somebody told you that your son he was traveling and he arrived. So you say, oh, alhamdulillah, that Allah returned my son safe to me. So, and you go down and you pray, you make sujood. And also, for example, somebody told the news that you got promotion. You were at work. Somebody told you can make sujood in your place. And it's not necessary to have wudu or anything. This is called sujood al-shukr. So you can make sujood and you can make dua. But just to come and to make sujood just for the purpose of dua, it's not right. I mean, I don't know that there's any practice that was done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Sahaba to do just sujood to make the dua specifically for making dua. But the Muslim sometimes, if he want to ask something, like for example Salatul Istikhara, so he salli, that means you pray two rak'ah, and during your sujood, while you are praying this two rak'ah, you can make whatever dua. So in conclusion, we said a sujood, I mean the dua, you can make it in any sujood, but not to initiate sujood just for making the dua.
Sheikh, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received news that his son had expired, I think he got down from the camel and he made sujood. What classification would this be?
Say it again. Son, kusuf, you mean, or what?
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he received news that his son passed away,
yes,
he got down from the camel and he made sujood, I think, right?
I'm not sure about this. I'm not sure about this point. But as I mentioned, there is sujood al-shukr. Sujood al-shukr, you know, to thank Allah Azza wa Jal. But I'm not sure about this point. We will check this, inshallah. Thank you.
Jazakumullah khair,
Sheikh. Wa iyyakum Allah. Na'am. Any question? Tab, I have some question here which is written by some brothers. It said, explain more time, this is from Brother Shamaz again, difference between tamna', na'am, tanha wa tamna', and why some of those who pray still sin while in salawat. Yeah, this is the point we say, you know, al-farq bayna tamna' wa tanha. As I mentioned, the principle is the more you are near to Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will protect you from committing sin. So doing salah, more salah, by itself, it will make shield between the person and committing sin. But why there are some people who are praying and still they are committing sin? There is different reason. One is there is a problem with the salah. It's not perfect as it should be. It may not be sincere. The intentions may not be, you know, completely for Allah Azza wa Jal. This is one reason. And another reason my dear brothers, you know. Now, when the person good do the good deeds, he should continue. Should continue. As we mentioned from the beginning, when we say the good deeds will lead to good deeds, and bad deeds will lead also to bad deeds. So the same thing, so the person who is praying and also keeping his prayer and returning to Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah Azza wa Jal protect him from doing or committing more sin. And this could be explained by the hadith Qudsi, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا افْتَرَفْتَهُ عَلَيْهِ. My slave or my servant never ever please me or getting near to me by doing something more than what I commanded him to do. That's mean obligatory acts. Like for example, Salah, what's the most beloved thing to Allah Azza wa Jal is that you do the compulsory Salah, the obligatory Salah on time in the perfect way. This is most beloved to Allah than doing many other nawafil or options. طيب. And then what Allah said in this hadith Qudsi, وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ. And my servant still try hard to please me by doing more of the optionals, more of voluntary prayers or nawafil, good deeds, ta'at. And then he said, وَلَا يَزَالُ, still continue, till what? حَتَّى أُحِبُّهُ, till I love him. So when the Muslim try hard to please Allah Azza wa Jal by doing the salah on time, more fasting, you know, whatever Allah commanded him, he do it, and then he add by doing more good deeds, more recitation of the Quran, more sadaqat, more salah, more fasting, more of every good things, till Allah will love him. Because you are getting near to Allah by these good deeds. Till Allah loves you. So what's the fruit of this love from Allah? قَلْ حَتَّى أُحِبُّ فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ. Look at the fruit. And when I love him, what will happen to you when I love you? When Allah loves you, what will happen? حَتَّى أُحِبُّ فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ. And then when I love him, كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ. Just to conclude and to summarize the hadith, that means Allah Azza wa Jalla saying, when I love him, then I will protect his hearing, his sight, all his action, so he will do only the good things. So the person, when he finds himself overwhelming with this bad deeds, that means he is in danger. That means he should return to Allah. He should repent to Allah. He should do more good deeds to Allah and asking him all the time that, Oh Allah, protect me. Protect me from my desires. Protect me from myself. Protect me from the shaitan. Protect me from not doing what you commanded me. Protect me to do more to please you. Subhanallah. And then Allah Azza wa Jal. So the salah, more salah, by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, if it was perfect, inshallah it will be has good effect on the person. Now,
JazakAllah khair,
Shaykh. There's one question here. It said, also sujood, shukr, should it be directed to Qibla? No. If you know the Qibla, that's great. It should be, but if you don't know the Qibla, you are good news come to you and they said you get this or you get that, or Allah prevent this to happen to you, and you just go down and prostrate, it's okay. But if you know the Qibla, then it's better to turn to the Qibla. Nah. Barakallah fikum. Jazakumullah khair. For brothers in the who are posting questions on the WhatsApp, in the Facebook, inshallah I will write the answer, inshallah, to their question on the comments. جزاكم الله خير. طيب بارك الله فيك يا شيخ عبد المجيد. And also here I just would like to remind my brothers, myself, to pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to reward our brother Abdul Majid, you know, the the admin, in fact, because he is the one who prepared this channel for us to deliver these, inshallah, lessons and these classes. Jazakallah khair. Wa barakallahu feekum. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum.